Hello everybody and welcome back. We have just finished studying all the anatomy of the respiratory system in great detail. Now it's time for us to understand how it actually works. So we're going to concentrate on three or four physiology concepts on respiration. We're going to start with the first one, which is how do we actually breathe in and breathe out? So we're starting with the concept of respiratory ventilation. So in ventilation, we are looking at the process of inspiration and expiration, how air enters the lung and how air leaves the lung. In order to understand this concept, we're first going to study the respiratory muscles. There have to be certain muscles that will move the chest wall. So we're going to look at those two groups of important muscles. First is the diaphragm, and second are the intercostal muscles that are in between the ribs. Let's look at what happens to the movement of those muscles during inspiration. So in inspiration, the diaphragm will contract and move down. The intercostal muscles will contract and they will pull the chest wall outwards. During this process, we have to note that with the movement of the diaphragm down and the pulling of the chest wall out, we have increased the volume inside the thorax, a very important concept. In the process of expiration, the opposite is occurring. The diaphragm is now going to relax and dome upwards. All of the intercostal muscles are going to relax and the chest wall is going to move inwards. And when this occurs, the volume inside the thorax is going to decrease. All right, so far we know the respiratory muscles and the volume changes during ventilation. How does this affect air actually going in and out the muscles? The chest. This is explained by Boyle's law. So Mr. Boyle noticed something and he said there is an inverse relationship between the volume and the pressure. As long as the temperature is constant, the inverse relationship is going to be once I increase the volume, I decrease the pressure. If I increase the volume in a certain area, pressure goes down. The exact opposite. If we decrease the volume, we increase the pressure. I made the volume smaller in this area, pressure went up. So now we are going to apply Boyle's law to ventilation. So we're going to look at pressures. We already talked a little about volume. We're going to visit this again, but we're looking at pressures. So the pressures that actually affect ventilation, we're going to look at two of them and the third one in a little later. We're going to look at atmospheric pressure. This is the pressure of the atmosphere surrounding us where we're going to take air in and breathe it. This atmospheric pressure has a known number, is 760 millimeters mercury at sea level. And this does not change unless we change our location. So look at this number, it's not going to change. It's 760 millimeters mercury. Now, the second pressure that works in the process of ventilation is the intrapulmonary pressure. We are looking at the pressure inside here, inside the lungs. Sometimes we call it intraalveolar pressure, right here. And this pressure is going to differ. And the difference is going to be always compared to atmospheric. So if it goes lower, it's going to be minus one or minus two compared to atmospheric. Or if it goes higher, it might be higher, 1 or 2 millimeters mercury greater than atmospheric. So we're going to look here. At rest, the two pressures are equal and there is no air going in or out of the lungs. During inspiration, what happens? We're going to go back to the concept of volume. My muscles have contracted. I have increased the volume inside the thorax. If I increase the volume, according to Boyle's law, pressure will drop. And all I need is a pressure drop 1 or 2 millimeters mercury less than atmospheric. And if there's less pressure inside here, air will flow from the atmosphere inside the lungs. During expiration, the muscles will relax. We accordingly will decrease the volume inside the thorax. If I decrease the volume, I increase the pressure. It might only be by 1 or 2 millimeters mercury more than atmospheric, and this will push the air and it will flow out of the lungs. So we're going to put all of these together in a very nice step-by-step understanding of the concept. So we're looking at the muscles contracting during inspiration. I have increased the volume. If I increase the volume, pressure decreases less than atmospheric and air will flow in. We see how the volume expands during inspiration. In expiration, the muscles will relax and the volume will decrease. Pressure increases. We can see the volume has decreased. Pressure increases above atmospheric and air will flow outside the lungs. So this is the normal process of airflow inside and outside the lungs, the process of ventilation. Now this is in a normal person during the resting breathing. We're going to look at factors that can affect this airflow. Is it constant all the time? Does it differ? Are there certain diseases that will increase or decrease the airflow in and out of the lungs? So we're going to go back to our flow equation. We looked at this before. So flow equals delta P, which is the pressure gradient, the pressure difference, the difference in pressures we were just talking about, divided by R, which is the resistance. So if I increase the resistance, flow will decrease. So what are the factors that can actually change the airflow? We're going to look first at changes in atmospheric pressure. We're going to look at changes in resistance. Specifically, we're going to talk about the airway diameter, the alveolar surface tension, lung compliance, and last, we're going to look a couple of minutes briefly at the intrapleural pressure. So let's start by looking at changes in atmospheric pressure. The higher we go above sea level, atmospheric pressure is going to decrease. So if there is lower atmospheric pressure, it's going to be harder for airflow to enter the lungs. So it's very common if you see people hiking and going to high altitudes, if you look at them, they are going to be trying to voluntarily gasp for air and take breath in because atmospheric is lower, it's not helping to push air in. The diameter of the bronchioles. This is a very important concept. If the diameter decreases, understandably, there's going to be less air flow. So what are factors that can actually constrict the bronchioles? We are going to look here. Bronchioles are surrounded by smooth muscle. In certain disease states, very well known in asthma, there is constriction of the bronchioles because of these muscles, they go into spasm and they contract, and the diameter of the airways is going to decrease, and I would expect that airflow is going to decrease. Also, sometimes it's not only the muscle, sometimes because of inflammation, there is swelling of the mucosa or there is accumulation of fluid, and this also will decrease the airflow and increase the resistance to that airflow. We're going to look at what we call alveolar surface tension. Now, what is alveolar surface tension? We're looking at the alveoli over here that are filled with air. There is also a very thin film of water vapor inside each of those alveoli. And if we remember from chemistry, one of the most important characteristics of water molecules is that they attract each other and they want to grow closer to each other. They want to bind each other. And if we leave them to do that and we come to very small alveoli, they might actually pull together and collapse the whole alveolus. For this not to occur, we know that there is a certain cell inside the alveoli which secretes a substance called the surfactant. What does surfactant do? Surfactant will come and will insinuate itself in between the water molecules and pull them apart. So this will decrease the surface tension and will prevent the alveoli from actually collapsing. So this is a normal adult person. Sometimes in situations where we have premature babies, their lungs are not fully developed and they don't have enough surfactant. They have deficiency in surfactant. And so the lungs can collapse and this will definitely decrease the airflow inside the lung. So remember, surfactant decreases the surface tension, allows good airflow. If we have deficiency in surfactant, collapse of the lung will occur and there is less airflow. Lung compliance. What do we mean by lung compliance? It's the ability of the lung to freely expand and inflate with air. So are there factors that affect the lung compliance? Yes. The first one is chest wall deformities. And this is a common example here. This is a deformity in the spine, and this is called kyphosis. And because of this deformity, it's hard for the chest wall to expand and for the lungs to inflate. So definitely airflow in this person is going to be diminished. What else can affect compliance? Certain lung diseases can either increase or decrease the ability of the lung to expand. We're looking at a lung disease here called lung fibrosis. In lung fibrosis, if I look, there is deposition of fibrous tissue in between the alveoli. And this fibrous tissue will decrease the ability of the alveoli to expand fully, and definitely airflow will decrease. The exact opposite is a very common disease called emphysema. In emphysema, there is destruction of the elastic fibers that surround each of those alveoli. And if I have destruction of the fibers, when this person breathes in, the lung will expand more than normal. So there is increase of compliance in emphysema. One third example we should not leave outside is tumors of the lung. These are definitely space-occupying lesions. They will push on an area of the lung and will prevent it from inflating, and definitely this will decrease compliance. The third factor that affects airflow is the intrapleural pressure. What is intrapleural pressure? It's the pressure here inside the pleural space between the two layers of the pleura. And let me start by saying intrapleural pressure is always a negative pressure. It's always 2 or 3 millimeters less than atmospheric. And it has to remain negative, whether in the phase of inspiration or expiration. And what does it do? It has like a sucking effect. So there is a negative pressure here, there is a sucking effect, and this will keep the lung inflated. So if there is any situation where intrapleural pressure increases, it will push on the lung, and definitely this will decrease the airflow in the lung. And this is a common situation here where we have penetrating wounds to the chest. This will allow the higher atmospheric pressure to enter the pleural space, and we will see pneumothorax will occur, and this will collapse the lung. And the only way, understandably, to treat this person is to put in a chest tube and apply negative pressure. And when we do that, we are pulling the air out of the thorax, and we allow the lung to re-expand, and airflow will return back to normal. To summarize, we're talking about the process of ventilation, how air enters and leaves the lungs, and we spoke about factors that can affect the airflow. So, how many times do we breathe, and how much air is actually going in and out? We are breathing at a rate of 12 to 15 breaths per minute. With every breath, we take in around 500 ml of air, and we exhale that at the same time also. So, how do we regulate this respiratory rate? We're going to discuss this in the next topic of respiratory regulation. Thank you.